Hallo und herzlich willkommen bei der 15. FranceCon 2020 hier im Online-Stream. Ja, und herzlich willkommen, besonders Frank Kalicek mit dem Thema How Nextcloud Stayed Productive During COVID and How 19 and How Others Did the Same. So, here is Frank Kalicek by the 15th FranceCon 2020 and yeah, have fun.
Thanks a lot. Thanks a lot for having me today. As already mentioned, the topic of my talk is how Nextcloud stayed productive during COVID-19 and how others can do the same. A little bit about me. My name is Frank Kalicek. I was born in Reutlingen, Germany here. I still will do my presentation in English so that more people can understand it, hopefully. I studied computer science, but most of my life I was involved in all kinds of different open source projects. I was a board member of the KDE EV for a while, founded a bunch of other projects, WRC, invited experts, advisor to the United Nations, but I'm probably most well known as founder of Nextcloud. So today I want to talk a little bit about the COVID-19 situation we have here at the moment and the challenges that brings it for all of us. Then how we work inside Nextcloud in this special situation, also with Nextcloud, obviously. Then talk a little bit about our distributed open source community, which is also interesting in this special times. Some social aspects about how to work and how to live together with social distancing, and at the end of summer. Okay, let's talk about the current changes. As you all know, we are currently in the COVID-19 pandemic, which is one of the worst pandemics in recent history. We have numbers from yesterday, 23 million documented cases and 800,000, over 800,000 dead. So this is obviously very serious, and we're still as the world community, as mankind, we're still trying to figure out how to deal with that, how we can handle that. One of the things that definitely helps is social distancing. So this means that we all stay at home as much as possible, that we avoid contact with others as much as possible to avoid to spread the disease, obviously. So this means that we all, most of us doing home office, that we're no longer in our companies or universities or other places, but we mainly stay at home and we work from home, which comes with all kinds of challenges that I'm going to talk about in this talk here. It also means that schools are closed, which means kids are at home at the moment. So parents have special challenges with looking after their kids, caring about their kids, while they would usually like work at a time. So they have to balance not only the home office, the remote work, but also looking after the kids at the same time, which is a special challenge. Of course, it also means that we no longer have in-person events and conferences and meetups. And this here is a photo of the Nextcloud conference from last year in Berlin. It was a really nice big event. Obviously, we're not going to do that anymore this year. So we are doing an online virtual event, same as FrostCon here. Let's see how it goes. I hope it all will be fine, but of course it is a new challenge. It comes with the COVID-19 situation. But of course there are like more serious problems than online conferences, which is, for example, the challenges a lot of us have with isolation. As we all know, humans are social animals, so we like to talk and interact and meet other people, but staying at home all the time is not easy for most of us, just from a private perspective, but of course also from a co-working perspective, from a company, from a job perspective. But of course, the worst is really the serious health implications. So as mentioned, a lot of people are actually in hospitals with serious diseases, and lots of people are dying. So that's all a big, big dramatic thing that happened here this year. A lot of us have the impression that, yeah, but that's all bad. This was a few weeks and months ago, but now everything is getting better. We will be over that very soon, no problem. Unfortunately, that's not really the case. If you look at the latest numbers, these are the infections, the infections that in the world, that's a global graph here. As you can see, it goes up. It's not going down. It's not even stable. As you can see, these are the over 23 million cases that I mentioned earlier. Here are the deaths, over 800,000 deaths already. And as you can clearly see, there is no sign of like going down or stabilizing or whatever. Like this is like going up. That's a problem. So this situation will not change anytime soon, unfortunately. We all wish it would, but it definitely most likely won't. So what do we do here? How does this change our work life? How does it change our how we work together? How does this change our company cultures and everything? So this is a photo of an of an office where everybody is crowded together to work on things together, 9 to 5 in a usual company. Obviously, this is not happening anytime soon anymore. Yeah, typical meeting, right? The younger of us still remember from last year where we had like meetings to brainstorm things, to discuss things, to create consensus for new ideas. Meetings are, if you like it or not, a very common tool that are very popular and common in companies. And of course, they also don't happen like that anymore. So what's going to happen? What's going to change? And this leads me to Nextcloud. This is why I'm happy to be here today and talk a little bit about Nextcloud. And the reason that I'm invited here to this nice event is probably three things. First is that Nextcloud is, of course, a very big distributed international community and a very international open source community. And as you know, some of you might know, open source communities are like, we're doing social distancing forever, right? Because like we are not all in the same building, we are spread all over the planet. So there's something to learn from this open source communities. The second is that Nextcloud is also a distributed company with people in 11 countries. So we are doing home office remote work forever. This is like part of our culture. And I want to talk a little bit about that, what's important here and how this can work. And last but not least, Nextcloud is obviously a tool for remote work for home offices. So Nextcloud was always designed as a tool, open source, on-premise, self-hosted tool to work together, not to get in person, but over the internet remotely. And this is also something where I want to talk about. So this is why I'm happy to be here today. So I think a few things will change in the future, especially if you compare this with classic companies who have this classic 9-to-5 office buildings, meetings, cultures. A lot of things change in the future. The first is, I think there will be more flexibility in time, place, and speed. What do I mean with that? With time, I mean, well, not everybody is sitting in front of the computer at the same time. Right, and in an old office building, everybody is in the same building at the same time. But as I mentioned earlier, some people have to look after their kids. Some people are maybe in different time zones at, after all. Maybe some people need to look after their relatives. Maybe someone is sick. So we are all like running around trying to organize our lives. So you can't assume that everybody is working at the same time. It's all spread out all over the clock. Then place. Obviously, we are all not together, all in the same building. We are distributed. This is something that is has a lot of consequences. With how well we can't work with paper, for example, as easily. It has lots of consequences. I will come back to this later. And then speed. That's also very important. We can't assume that all our coworkers are always as productive as others. I mean, we all have to deal with the situation and we all have to handle things somehow. And some of us might, I don't know, need time to look after the neighbors because there's a problem. Or like maybe are completely distracted with their kids or maybe are struggling with a depression or other things. So we all have to be patient with each other. We have to understand that we have to go through this together, and we can't assume that everything is working as it was before. The second is asynchronous communication. I think this is something that we will see more and more. What do I mean with that? Synchronous communication for me is like everybody being at a phone together, have a video call together, have a meeting together, which means everybody is doing the same thing at the same time. As I mentioned before, this is difficult because maybe someone can't join a meeting because they have to bring their kids to the doctor or something, and maybe not possible. This is why asynchronous communication becomes more and more important. For example, chat is a very good tool for that, or email and other tools. And I will talk about this later. Then transparency, being as open as possible to everyone, right? We have the situation now that we are all sitting in our home offices, spread out on our own, and we are really disconnected from the rest of the organization, from the rest of the company. So we don't really feel connected to everything. Like, we don't have all the information. We're not, like, I don't know, chatting with the person in the next office about something. We are not really bind together as a group as before. So we spread out. So this requires that we all are as open, as communicative as possible to make sure that all information, everything reaches each other. We shouldn't have like a lot of like internal secret conversations, but really trying to be as open as possible so that everybody is included in the organization and everything that's happening. Trust is very important. That's something that's especially important for managers. You can see this in a lot of companies where like managers are mainly concerned about when does someone start to work, when does someone stop to work, how long is the lunch break, and stuff like that. Obviously, when everybody's in the home office doing remote work, you don't really know when the person starts to work and stops to work and how much break and private stuff they do in between, right? It's just, you can't micromanage people anymore. And you have to stop doing this. You have to trust people that they are doing the best for the company, for the organization. And you basically need to, this comes to the next point, work more result-oriented. You should care about what is the outcome of the work and not so much how many hours was the person sitting in front of the computer in the office. That's not really important. It's really important what is produced and where these results are produced and when should not be important. Communication is key. We really need to over-communicate. We really need to talk with everybody as much as possible because remote work is a burden on communication. It's really hard to stay connected, to stay in touch. So communication is so important. So all kinds of communication tools are really key. Again, I will talk about it later. Okay, so how do we work at Nextcloud? Because as I mentioned, we do this for many years already, and we have a tool for that. And maybe it makes sense to go through that to tell you a little bit how this all can be done with the help of Nextcloud as a tool for that, and also with the right company culture and workflows, because the tool alone is obviously not enough. The first thing I want to talk about is access. So that's something that is maybe obvious, and I'm sure there are a lot of like IT-minded people here listening to this talk, attending this conference here. So for us, it's like obvious that you have a laptop and you have a smartphone and then you have a fast internet connection and everything. But for a lot of people, it's actually not obvious. Some have a laptop, but then you have to use like VPNs to connect to it, and maybe the laptop is slow or don't even have a laptop. So this whole access of the IT systems of the company is not so easy. So I think what we really should do is we should endorse bring your own device. So the company has to relax what kind of device is used. It shouldn't really matter if it's the company laptop or the private laptop or the private smartphone or a tablet or whatever, right? It should not be important. So everybody should have the best possible tool to do the job. And if the tool is a private tool, then this should also be possible. And also this whole concept of connecting to a VPN to access the internal systems, that's something that's really clunky and slow, and I think that's not really the future. Of course, there are a lot of options and tools still to secure all the data. That's what the IT department is concerned about. I mean, with Nextcloud, for example, we have a lot of options to define policies, password policies, for example, that passwords are regularly changed or have a certain strength and so on. There's also a way to secure access with two-factor authentication, with a hardware token, YubiKey, one-time password, SMS, email, push notification, all kinds of things. This is something that I would say is strongly recommended, because maybe you're logged into the browser, into the company tool, into Nextcloud, for example, on your iPad, and then an hour later, the iPad is grabbed by your kid and playing a game, and then suddenly the kid has access to it's playing around with in the company tool. So obviously this needs to be secured, and there are really good ways, for example, two-factor authentication to secure that. If a device is lost, if a device is no longer trusted, there's also a way to remotely wipe it. So inside Nextcloud, there's a button where you can wipe a device if you somehow no longer know where the phone is. Maybe the kid played with it and it's lost somehow, you don't know, and you can just wipe it just to be sure. And later, if you find it again, no problem, just log in and all your data is synced back. That's no problem. And also, the administrator can also, of course, wipe all devices of the user too if this is needed. Another interesting thing is suspicious login detection. So as an IT administrator, you might think, okay, well, now suddenly all my employees, they're all connecting to the service from all over the world. What is happening? I mean, I see in the log file that there's a connection from this IP address, but do I really know who this is? Maybe it's a hacker, maybe it's a real person. So we have a feature called the suspicious login detection, which actually is using machine learning, which learns login behavior. So it recognizes if someone who never logs into Nextcloud at 3 a.m. from an IP address from China, maybe that's a bit suspicious and you get a warning and the administrator can get a warning and so on. So this can be detected. So you can really be sure that if you allow all your employees to access it from home, it's still secure. And if you really want to, you can even configure additional access control rules. You can, for example, say that certain files that are really tagged as super secure, VIP, whatever, can only be accessed from home offices, from a certain IP address, from people in the VIP group at a certain time, from a certain device type, and so on. So you can really restrict certain files types to certain LDAP groups, to certain tags, time, and IP addresses. So we can really also really harden the system and say, okay, well, this in this area, for example, here we have the finance data. This is only accessible for these people from this certified IP space and so on. And there's also end-to-end encryption, which is a very nice feature for additional hardening. That's something we launched, I think, a week ago that's supported in all our clients, Mac, Windows, Linux, iOS, Android. So you can end-to-end encrypt all your files for additional security. So this is just the first part. This is just accessing the system, okay? And believe me, it's already hard enough for a lot of organizations who are really not used to work like that. But okay, now you can access the system, but what do you really do with the system? There are a lot of things, and I will come to some of them, but first it really starts with accessing files and documents. So accessing all your data from home is obviously the first step for being productive. But believe me, this is hard enough. Because in a lot of organizations, a lot of companies, this is on paper, right? They really work with a lot of paper. The paper is in the office, the paper is not at home. Maybe you print out a document at home, but then you have it and your coworker doesn't have it. So this doesn't work. So we really have to move to a paperless office and do everything digitally. This is for a lot of younger people. Maybe everybody here who's listening to this talk is quite obvious, but believe me, if you go to a normal old school company, this is mind blowing that you shouldn't really use paper that much. Then the second thing is, if they use digital documents, then a lot of organizations, they really use a classic file server or SharePoint or something like that. And these tools are not really suitable for this kind of remote work. So really should use like a file sync and share solution as Nextcloud here to manage all your documents. That's of course possible here. You have the benefit of, for example, accessing the files from all your devices. You have like nice thumbnails. I mean, in this case, only pictures, but the same is with PDF and Office documents. You have a nice sidebar on the right-hand side where you can comment files and have activities and chat and have sharing. And I will come back to some of those later. But this is a really powerful tool to access all your data from remote. Doesn't matter where you are. Obviously, you can not only access your own documents, but you can share it with others. So you can share it with people on inside the organization, with groups or with users, but you can also send share links to people outside the organization. And there we really have a lot of security features like hide the download button or upload only password protection, expiration date, and so on. It's a really powerful way to work together with people that are not sitting in the same office with you. Another very interesting feature of Nextcloud that helps here is are these project workspaces here, these rich workspaces. So you must know that in a big organization, you have like a huge server here. You have a huge file sync and share server. Maybe we have 100,000 of folders for all kinds of things. And it's really, really hard to really understand which folder, where should I look for, what document, what is happening here, where should I save it, where does it come from, what does it mean? So we have this feature where you can click on every folder you want and you can actually document it. You can click on it and you get a nice editor here on top where you can basically document what's going on in this folder. You even have features like having checkboxes. If this is some kind of documents that are about to change, you can define milestones and all kinds of things. And you can really document what these files are. And that's something that's available on all devices, on the web interface, iOS, Android, and so on. You can lock a file if you want to work on a file on an airplane and you don't want others to change the file. If a file is locked and you want to work on it, you can just click on it and open a chat and ask, hey, why is the file locked? Can you please unlock it? And then you can coordinate who is changing the file when. It's of course also super important if you work in different time zones and remote, you can't really know what others are doing at the moment. Of course, you can also work on your mobile devices. Nextcloud has very rich apps, Android and iOS in this case, where you can really do basically all operations also on the go, on your phone and your tablet. It's of course very convenient because not everybody's sitting behind a desk all day. You have push notifications on all your devices if you want that, so you can stay up to date, you know what's going on, even if you don't sit in front of a computer. You can see there's a comment or you're invited to a document or there's an incoming call or something like that. Of course, there's also desktop integration. So you have a nice, powerful desktop app, Mac, Windows, and Linux, where you can also see what's going on in your company, what's going on in your Nextcloud. You can see all the activities here on the desktop, also get the notifications as before. You can directly on the desktop, if you don't like web interfaces, you don't have to use it, you can directly on the desktop just right-click on a file and share it, also with all the permissions, see all the notifications. It's very nicely integrated, just feels like one workspace. Very nice feature is the data access engine. So because a lot of organizations still has, as I mentioned before, file servers and SharePoint servers and other things, but they're not really accessible from remote. As I mentioned before, sometimes it's done via VPN, but that's not really the solution. That's not really convenient. So something we can do in Nextcloud is you can actually mount those data sources inside Nextcloud and then access it through Nextcloud from your home office and from your tablet and all your devices. And this works with all kinds of different protocols, as you can see. We even support access control lists. So if you really want to have fine-grained control, who has access to what financial data, from what LDAP group, and so on, you can do that. There's a full-text search. Very, very powerful. If you're a big organization and you really want to find a file about a specific topic, you can use the full text search. It's very nice. So this all helps together to access all your data. But as I mentioned before, accessing data is only the first step, because as I said, communication is really the key. So now I want to talk a little bit about the communication and how it can be used. A very, very popular and very powerful tool is chat. There are several reasons for that. The most important one is probably that it's asynchronous. So if you're chatting in a chat room about a specific topic, not everybody has to be there at the same time, because maybe you're distracted somewhere, you're running around and doing something else, and then an hour later or a day later, you come back and you can just scroll back and read everything, and then you're up to date. So it's a very nice way for more flexible working together. And with chat, by the way, I mean mainly these group chats. It's something the older of us might know as IRC. Yeah, this exists forever. Nowadays, we have tools like Slack, Microsoft Teams, or in this case, Nextcloud Talk, of course. And it's a very, very powerful tool to stay in contact in a company and organization. Of course, you also can do video calls with lots of people. That's also possible, Nextcloud Talk. Here on the left-hand side, you see an overlay of a mobile device. We can also join all the calls on a mobile device. We even get push notification if something happens. It's very, very nice. Video calls are a very good tool. Of course, it has the problem that everybody has to be ready at the same time. And that's sometimes useful, but yeah, sometimes it's not so good. We have very rich mobile apps, as mentioned, also for chatting. You get push notification if something happening, if you're invited to a call and so on. It's quite powerful. Really, it's a nice tool to stay connected. By the way, this is, again, same as everything from Nextcloud. This is all open source and can be hosted by yourself, right? That's the main difference to Microsoft and Google and other tools. You can do screen sharing. If you want to work together on with an application that we don't support with collaborative editing, in this case, I think it's a Photoshop or something file, then someone can share the file and then other can give feedback and click around. And that's a way to work together with the screen sharing. Also doing presentations like that, obviously. You can just take a file, directly drag it into a chat channel, and then everybody in the chat channel has access to the file and then can edit it and view it together. That's super, super popular feature. You can have a webinar or a conference like that one, where you have a room that only opens at a certain time. Before that, there's a lobby. It's a very useful tool for more organized meetings. Then we have a challenge with sharing files that are super confidential. So maybe if the manager of a company wants to share a very confidential file with an employee, of course, can just do it by normally sharing it with Nextcloud or sending a share link. The problem is, of course, that as I mentioned before, maybe the kid is playing with an iPad and sees the link and clicks on it and then sees some confidential data. That's a bit of a problem, obviously. For that, we have this very secure feature here, where if you click on the link, you first initiate a video call. They verify that it's really your coworker that you're talking to is really the right person here behind the other device. And then if you verify each other, yeah, that's the right person, you just type in the password, click on the link, and then you have access to the data. It's secured that the file is not intercepted by someone else. As a feature for bots, that can be useful to automate things. And of course, you can also chat around shared files that are very, very interesting also outside the company. There's a high performance backend to make Nextcloud Talk scale better to a lot of users. One interesting thing here is the SIP bridge, that this whole video conferencing system that I showed earlier, it's also accessible via phone. You know, so we have a SIP bridge, a SIP dial-in, which means you can actually call into rooms with a phone. Why is this important? Well, in our experience, not everybody has always a super fast internet connection. That's a challenge, especially in Germany sometimes in some areas. Then you really can't basically participate in calls. But it's possible to dial in with a normal phone, which most times works better. So actually, we introduced this system lately for the Berlin government, and they had a problem that the system was working well, servers, everything was super performant, but the problem was that the internet connection inside the offices were not fast enough. So, but they also used the option to dial in via phone in cases where the internet is slow. Okay, so now we are communicating and now we are access to data. But of course, you want to edit the data, edit the documents, and I want to talk a little bit about that. So we have a very nice tool inside Nextcloud's Markdown Editor. That's not a real like Office editor, right? That's not an Office document, but it's a simple Markdown, and it can be used for like to-do lists or meeting notes or brainstorming documents. And we inside Nextcloud use it all the time. Very nice, especially because it also works collaboratively, which means I can just open a document, invite someone else, and then with two cursors, we're working on the same document together. That's super, super nice. And of course, we can combine this with chatting and with a video call. So maybe we have a brainstorming topic, we just have this video call. In this case, here, two people chatting together and then working together in the same document. That's something we do all the time, and it's so nice. And it doesn't really matter where the other person is. One person can be on desktop, one person can be on a tablet. It's still the same experience. Of course, what you also want to do is edit like real Office documents. And we have integration into OnlyOffice and Collabora Online, where you can edit like full compatible Microsoft Office documents or ODF files directly inside Nextcloud. Of course, also collaboratively. So you can have like several cursors at the same time in the same document working together. And again, you can combine this with video calling and with chatting. That's super, super powerful. This is like something that not even in Microsoft Office 365 works so nicely. Where you really can have a very smooth call, chatting, working same document, jump in, jump out, everything transparent. That's really, really nice. Of course, also works on mobile devices. In this case, on a tablet. This is our mobile app where you have like, your files on the left-hand side and the document on the right-hand side. Again, you can work together on the same document. That's quite powerful. So if you want to share and your documents with other people, sometimes you want to share it like very confidentially. So for that, we have some security features where Office documents are only shared with watermarks or only like view only if they're tagged with a certain tag and so on. So again, security is very important. If you do this like remote work, working from home, distributed work, then there are actually tools to make your data protected and not make it leak outside your organization. Now I want to talk a little bit about the last part, that's groupware. That's of course features like a calendar. I mean, calendar might sound a little bit boring, but actually have a very nice calendar is very important for yourself to organize your day if you're all the time at home, but also of course shared calendars with your coworkers so that you actually know when is someone available and when not. In normal organizations, you assume that you're in the office 9 to 5 or something. But in this home office, that's not really the case. So it's really nice to have these shared calendars to see what your coworkers are doing and when. And of course, you have all the features with inviting people, having reminders, repeating events, and so on. Also very important is the free busy support, where you can see, hey, I want to have a call. And are all the coworkers available at the same time? Or when should I do the call? That's very important, especially now that there's no core work time anymore. Everybody's working like super early, super late. So the coordination is important. Nice feature inside the Nextcloud calendar is if you invite people to an event, to a meeting, for example, with one click, you can directly create the chat room and the video conferencing room and attach it to the invitation email. So everything is just set up with one click. There's also a way to read your mails. Email is still a thing. People try to kill email for a long time and replace it with chat. But email still exists, and we have a very rich, nice email integration. Of course, you can work with your attachments, attach files to emails, extract it there, save it directly into your Nextcloud. That's quite powerful. And there's even an option to automatically detect itineraries. So if you get like a booking from a train, well, train rides are not so common at the moment, or hotels, but all kinds of bookings are basically automatically detected inside Nextcloud Mail. And with just one click, you can put it into your calendar. A super, super, super important additional tool is Nextcloud Deck. So Deck is a Kanban-style project management tool. And that's really, really nice. You might think that project management, I'm not a project manager, why should I do that? It's so nice to coordinate things, I mean, maybe even for yourself as a to-do list, but also together with others to decide who is doing what, when, where. And this is following the Kanban style ideas. It's something that's used in Agile, the Agile world, and Agile doesn't need to be software development. Agile can be used for all kinds of projects. And that's something that's deeply integrated into Nextcloud, and with like deadlines and attachments and assigned people and tagging and comments and everything you expect. That's a very powerful tool to work together on a project, even if you're not in the same office. I heard that some people even use it to organize their families, who is doing what when. But you can of course also use it like for real bigger projects. That's quite nice. Okay, now I talked a lot about how Nextcloud can be used in a company, in an organization. But as I mentioned before, Nextcloud is also a very big open source community with over 2,000 contributors. And as I said, we are basically naturally forever socially distanced. So Nextcloud is forever distributed international, global, socially distant community. So how do we do that? How can we write software like that? How can we stay productive if you're not in the same building? I mean, for a lot of companies, this is mind-blowing. So as I said, we have over 2,000 volunteers worldwide, and they do everything. It's really from testing, feature requests, translation, packaging, promotion, bug fixing, feature development. Everything is done by the community. There's nothing the community is not able to do. I think with the right processes and the right tools, it's actually something that can work quite well. In our case, we use GitHub for that. But of course, you can also use GitLab or some other software. It doesn't really matter. But this modern code hosting and collaboration spaces are really, really nice and powerful. In our case, everything about Nextcloud that relates to code is on GitHub. This is the homepage here where you can see the core repositories, what's going on here, and you can just have a look. You can see what's going on and get involved. Everything is transparent and easy. For example, if you use Nextcloud and you find an issue, something you don't like, everybody can file a bug report. And the bug report can also be a feature request, by the way. It doesn't need to be a real bug, just feedback. Hey, I have an idea. Can you do this? Can you do that? And we have a lot of interesting discussions about that. Translations are something that's also happening. I think you can see here they have 96 languages at the moment. So Nextcloud is available in 96 languages. That's quite nice. And everything is done by, all over the world, people who speak 96 languages, and they can distribute. And this is all organized in a distributed way. No one is sitting in the same office. People basically never met each other in person, and it's still working. Promotion, if you want to promote Nextcloud, a lot of people run around and promote Nextcloud and don't really meet like other people before. It's really impressive, actually. And then, of course, maybe the core thing is contribute code. So that's something that's possible for everybody. So Nextcloud can be changed by everybody. Some people think that you need to be an employee or need special rights or something. Well, not really. It really can be done by everybody. The process is quite easy. You need to check out the the repository with the corresponding code, make your changes, create a pull request, that's one button, and then you wait for feedback and test. That's, of course, the, maybe the bit most complex part besides the changes, the coding. It means that automated tests need to be run. So we have a lot of automated tests that need to be executed to check if the code is okay. And then the code needs to be reviewed by two other people. So in a way, we have a 6i principle. So every code change needs to be reviewed both by the person itself and then by two additional people. And then you click the merge button and then it's changed. And it doesn't require that you're in the company, that you're in the same time zone, that you're in the same office, that you're in the same, speak the same language, that you have whatever in common. It's everything. So this is completely transparent, distributed, or remote work for office. So we actually, from a coding perspective, Nextcloud, we didn't see any problems or slow with the COVID-19 at all. So I'll talk a little bit about the social aspects, because so far we talked a lot of features. Sorry for that. Because the life is a bit more complex than features. So the social aspects are actually quite important for the current situation, COVID-19, home offices, and so on. So a lot of people have problem with isolation, depression, because as I mentioned, we are social animals. We like to work together with other people. We like to see them, interact with them. We're not really built for working in isolation from the home office. And that's also something that we noticed at in Nextcloud. As I mentioned before, we have the company culture that people work from different places, and that's all fine. But we still do regular meetings, and we still have some people who go to the same office. I mean, only like a fraction, but still a little bit. And we have a conference where we meet like once a year, a little bit, right? So we have a little bit of interaction, but this all, of course, doesn't happen anymore. And that's what's a problem for a lot of people. And we came up with some things to improve the situation. The first thing we did is a virtual water cooler, a virtual coffee machine. So the idea is that if you're working in the same office, then sure, you're sitting behind your desk, but also sometimes you walk around and maybe you go to the coffee machine and the water cooler or somewhere else. And there you might meet someone else from a completely different department, and maybe talk a little bit. And it's just like nice human interaction, communication. Also, you know a little bit about, hey, what others are doing. It's important. It's an important part of working together. So what we did, we have a special video call room that's open 24/7. And everybody who wants can just go there, click the join button, and then see if someone else is also standing next to the coffee machine at the moment. The virtual coffee machine, and then we can use like random people and we can talk a little bit. And yeah, because sometimes if you're just concentrated on something, you're writing a document or something, and then you really need to, I don't know, just walk around and talk with someone about something completely unrelated to it, open up your mind, and then later come back to work. And that's what we do with this virtual coffee machine video call. The second thing is, we have co-working calls. So that's something that might sound a little bit unusual, but for us, it's very, very effective. Imagine that in a normal company, you are sitting in an office, maybe four or five people sitting in the same office and they're working together on the same project. Maybe a software developers on the same feature, or maybe in marketing on the same marketing campaign, or you're preparing the same conference or something. Then the way this usually is that you're sitting behind your computer and you're concentrated on your work, but you're surrounded by your coworkers. And if you want to know something, you just shout into the room, hey, what was the name of this person again? What was the name of this variable or whatever? And for that, we have these co-working calls where you say, okay, here are 2, 3, 4 of us. Everybody is working on the same topic. We are just in the same call. It doesn't mean that we talk. We usually don't talk too much. We just work together. and we feel connected with each other, working on the same topic, and we can do a little bit, hey, great work, and then maybe silent for another 5 minutes, and then, hey, can you help me here? And then another silence for 5 minutes. So this is a bit like sitting in the same office. And we do this regularly, and this is actually very, very nice and productive. And the last thing is also something we introduced is that we call a beer o'clock or a social call. And we have this once a week in the evening. So this is an evening activity. This is not work related. So this is not part of the job. But we have like, I think it's at 8 o'clock on Wednesdays. We have this call where everybody who just wants to, I don't know, basically usually would go to a pub with your friends and colleagues can go to the call, and then we just talk about non-work related things. This is just like going to the pub with your coworkers. You can have a beer, some other drink wine or water, that's not the point. But it's just a social activity where you can talk with your colleagues. And this helps also again to not get crazy if you're sitting at home all the time. Okay, so coming to the end of my presentation. Now I want to a little bit of a sneak peek of Nextcloud 20, because as you know, we just released Nextcloud 19 a few weeks ago. It's a very nice release, but we are constantly learning. And also now with the COVID-19 situation, there are a lot of things we experience that we can improve in Nextcloud. And I'm not going to give you like the full overview. It's actually a very nice release with a lot of cool things, but I want to only talk about one thing because it's related to this topic. And that's called user status. So these are rough first screenshots. So sorry for that. But on the left, the screenshot on the left, you can see that this is the normal menu you get if you click on the top right avatar picture. And there you have this new button, set status. And this is something where a user can set the current status, like, hey, I'm working, I'm doing lunch break, I'm on vacation, I'm sick, I'm traveling, I'm do not disturb because I work on that, talking with a customer or whatever. Whatever they want to put in there. They don't have to, right? It's not mandatory, but if they want to communicate what they're doing, they can do it. And what does it mean? Several things. First of all, other people can get an overview on the right-hand side. You see this nice overview that people can see what people are doing. This person started to work, this person lunch break, this person is on vacation. You can see what your coworkers are doing. But also in the normal life, and this is the screenshot in the middle, it's always visible. For example, if I want to share a document with a coworker, then I just type in the username and you get this nice auto-completion drop-down that you can see here. And then you can already see, oh, wait, no, this user is actually on vacation, or this user is actually sick, or this user doesn't want to be disturbed. And then, okay, maybe I shouldn't like invite this person to a call, or I don't want to assign this project management to do to the person because he doesn't want to be disturbed, or he's just on lunch break and no, he's not available for a call now because he's like, yeah, not in front of the computer at the moment. And that's something that gives you the feeling of like, you know what their people are doing, you know, you don't want to disturb them if they're not really working. And you know who is ready for communication and who is not. And that's, for example, something that we learned from the current situation. And this is why we implemented this feature. And it will come with Nextcloud 20. Again, with actually a lot more. But that's, I want to show you that one because it is actually a result of the current home working situation. Okay, so this leads me to the summary, to the last slide. So I think remote work is something that's good, and I think it's not going away. It will stay around, and if it's done right, then it's actually not a compromise. I think we can turn this into a good thing for more flexibility. It also has concrete benefits, like no commute time, commuting costs money, traveling is a pain sometimes. So this is something, if it organize this in a good way, then all this commuting is no longer needed. Then work from anywhere you want. I mean, in Nextcloud, we have colleagues that are sometimes that tell me, hey, by the way, the next half year, I'm in Indonesia. Right? Or next, whatever, next, I'm just working from the house of a friend, or I'm just like working from the beach or something. And that's, of course, possible. And that's good for everybody, right? This makes people happy, more flexibility, and it's just good for everybody. Family friendly, right? Maybe you have a family, you don't have like the normal work hours, maybe you're busy with lots of things, and have just a more flexible, open, friendly workspace is just a good thing. And that's possible with remote work. And then from a company perspective, also working with the best people. This might sound weird, but if you have a company culture where everybody has to be in the same office, in the same building, then you can only hire people in the same city. Right? But if you can work with remote work, if your company is organized for remote work, yeah, then you can hire the best people, doesn't matter where they are. And for example, that's what we're doing with Nextcloud. This is why we produce in 11 countries. So I think it's at the end, it's a good thing for the company too. Of course, it requires the right tools and most important, the right company culture. But that's something that that's possible and it's going to happen and it will happen. Thanks a lot. And I don't know how this works here. If you still have time for questions, I hope so.
Yes, there's still time for some questions. Either they can be posted in the chat and you read them, after then you can answer them, or you can do it this voice too.
I can't see the chat at the moment, so maybe if there's a question, if someone could read it or ask via voice.
Yes, HCX23 asks, what about P2P encryption on Nextcloud Talk, and what about using SRTP or ZRTP?
So, I hear some background noise, but okay. So, so the thing is that, So the thing is that there are different modes in Nextcloud Talk. There is the default mode, Nextcloud Talk, which is peer-to-peer. So if you just install it and just run it without doing anything, it's doing peer-to-peer, which means it is end-to-end encrypted. This means that every browser sends makes an HTTPS connection to all other participants. And this is end-to-end, and nothing goes through the server. And it's actually very secure. It's, I mean, it's as secure as HTTPS is. The challenge is that the number of those connections grows exponentially with the number of people. So, for example, if you have 10 people in the room, then your browser needs to send your signal to 9 others and receive it from 9 others. And not only the network, but also the encoding and transcoding and decoding of the video and audio streams. And this creates uses some resources. So because of that, we have this special component. I mentioned briefly the high performance backend, where the data is sent to the server, aggregated, and sent out to everybody. The problem with this mode, this is the more this advanced mode, is that the data is actually sent to the server. I mean, and this theoretically, it would be possible if you have an evil admin that it somehow hacks the code and then does a man-in-the-middle attack. That's a weakness there. But there is actually a WebRTC protocol extension in the works, actually proposed by Google, where then the central component actually doesn't need to decrypt the data. In this case, it also would be secure. I don't know if this answers the peer-to-peer end-to-end encryption question. I hope so.
Yes, some more question. What algorithm is used by default for doing P2P encryption, and what about ECC?
What encryption is used? I mean, we are just using WebRTC, which is supported by the browser, and the browser is using HTTPS. So we haven't implemented any encryption at all at our site. We rely on the HTTPS transport layer. So whatever is implemented with HTTPS, also with the whole certificate system, that's used. We have no encryption on top of HTTPS. And ECC, do you mean error correction? Again, this is something we just rely on HTTPS and the WebRTC standard that's implemented by the browser. So we are not deep in the stack here. This is, we rely on the WebRTC implementation of the browser. So we don't have any error correction in our code. I mean, we have of course code for detecting reconnections and detecting slow networks, and we automatically reduce the quality if the network connection is not fast enough. So we have code for that, but we actually don't do any error correction in the stream itself.
Now ECC meant elliptic curve cryptography.
Okay, sorry. Yeah, again, we don't do any cryptographic activities at all in XLOTalk. The browser opens an HTTPS connection, and whatever this is in the browser implementation, that's what it is.
And there's some question asking if it will be able to cluster Nextcloud servers to deal some scaling.
Yeah. Good, excellent question. So the Nextcloud server is usually an application server using a web server and a PHP code. And here we can do just normal clustering. Some of our bigger users, and they have like 10 or 20, or some have over 100 of those application servers. And in front of that, you have usually a load balancer. That can be a hardware load balancer or HA proxy, which is commonly used for that. And this component distributes the HTTP requests, which coming from the outside through all those web servers. This web servers, the application servers, web servers, they need to access some shared resources. One is the storage. So you can have an S3 or Swift compatible object storage. Or an NFS storage. This can be done with Ceph, for example, Ceph cluster for storage. And additionally, you need some kind of database for metadata. This is something where you support Postgres, MySQL, MariaDB, the usual suspects who also support clustering on their own. And then additionally for caching, you can have a Redis component, and all of this together is actually quite scalable. So we have lot of bigger users who use this for several hundred thousand users at the same time. And there's also another way that we call global scale, where we can have a cluster of those clusters. Because we actually have one instance which has 20 million users. And in this case, you have different hosting centers on different continents, and they're talking to each other with this global scale architecture we have. It basically means that you have independent Nextcloud clusters, and they use our federation features to do sharing between different instances. And it's all done in a way that for a user, it looks like one service. It looks like, yeah, one URL you go to, you can do everything you want. But in reality, it's actually a cluster of clusters and can be on different continents. So that's something that can be done. The biggest installation is 20 million users. This works quite well. And for Nextcloud Talk, it's actually the same. So we have this high performance backend where you have a signaling server that's written in Go that can be clustered again with an HA proxy. We have a stun turn server, and then we have a SFU, which is a component and collects all the streams together and sends it out. And they're all components of those can also be clustered. So also for Nextcloud Talk, you basically scales linearly. The only limitation is that currently you can only have as many people in one room that is handled by one server. So I would say that a very fast server at the moment can do like 200, maybe 300 users. So this would be the limitation of people in one room, like 200 users in one room. But the number of rooms is basically unlimited because this scales linearly. So, but I can talk about it forever, but I hope this answers the rough question.
There was some other question asking for zero downtime upgrades in clustering.
Clustering, I think I just answered. What was the first part?
Zero downtime upgrades.
Zero downtime upgrade. Yeah, that's a common question. How we can do zero downtime? Sometimes it is related to backup. Sometimes it's related to upgrades. By default, backing up and also upgrading would mean putting Nextcloud in a single user or a read-only mode, doing the upgrade and then going starting it again, which depending on some other factors requires a downtime of really depends, like a minute or something, which in a lot of cases is okay that you have this like downtime of like 1 or 2 minutes in the middle of the night. That's usually okay, especially because all your clients keep on working, right? Your desktop clients, your mobile clients, they keep on working because they have everything cached offline. But if this is too long, if you really want to go down to like 1 second downtime, then there are some special tricks you can do with snapshotting in the database and the storage. But I think this is a little bit too far for this talk here. But there are ways, depending on the architecture and a good way of using snapshots, to bring this down to like 1 second. But less than 1 second is probably, I don't really know how, if this is possible. At the moment, that's the best we can do.
And someone asked if setting up a Nextcloud server will allow setting up your own encryption.
I don't know what an own encryption means. I mean, by default, again, all the transport is using HTTPS with normal certificates. We are not involved in that. We have a feature for server-side encryption and for end-to-end encryption. In these cases, we use normal Linux encryption libraries. We never implement any encryption system on our own. I think this would be a very stupid idea. We rely on normal AES 256. But all components that do encryption and decryption are actually pluggable. So they are plug-in interfaces. So some organization asked us if they want to use some other encryption system, then you can write a new plugin to plug in your own encryption system if you want to do that. But by default, we just use the standard Linux AES 256 encryption.
He wrote another line and said he meant certificates.
Ah, certificates. So again, I don't really have a good answer for that because we don't handle certificates. It is all, I mean, on the server side, the certificates are handled by the web server, again, as HTTPS and TLS itself too. So if you use Apache or Nginx or something, then this is where you can configure your certificates. And there are options in the web servers if you want to use some certain root certificates or some self-signed certificates and so on. That's very, very standard. So we don't really have our own certificate management because I really think it's not our business and it would be a bad idea. We just leverage operating system tools for that. Sorry to not give you any more interesting answer than that.
Okay, I think all of the questions were answered. Let's see, I have someone. Ah, here's something new. In the Corona situation, next to the private cloud, is it possible to share, for example, the gallery to the public by a link?
Yeah, that's a common request. There is a background noise again. Sorry. Thank you. There is a way to share a complete folder with your gallery in it via a link to someone else and click on it and it sees the pictures. That's possible. But I can also say that in the, probably not the next version, but in the version over that, after that, we are want to make this really, really cool. To make this a, I don't want to talk too much, but the whole use case of like sharing your media, your photos, your videos, something that you would usually at the moment share on Twitter or Facebook or YouTube, it would be nice to do this all in a decentralized, federated way. And we are working on something like that, also using the ActivityPub standard compatible to Mastodon and others. So that's the whole nice sharing of media in a nice way. It's a super interesting topic. And I'm quite sure that we do something cool about that soon. At the moment, the only thing you can do is share a link to a folder with pictures in it, which is also nice already. And because you can also then chat about the pictures, you can chat, everybody who was at the party can go into the chat channel and chat next to the pictures and whatever. That's already possible, but we will do this. We will make this very cool in the future.
One guest wants to know if you can outline a little bit how you can collaborate between the different instances of your
federation, yeah.
Yes.
So that's a core design goal of Nextcloud, because as I mentioned, and as everybody might know, Nextcloud is all about self-hosting. You can take Nextcloud code, put it on some Linux system, something, and you have your little own Nextcloud. The problem is that you're isolated from the rest of the world, because your own private instance. And because of that, we created several years ago this federation feature that you can actually work together and share stuff with people on other servers. So the idea is to do everything peer-to-peer. It's very similar if you think about email, for example. I mean, I can all run my own mail server, and I can create users on my mail server, and everybody on my mail server can send mails to each other. But it would be a very, very, very boring if I can't send mails to people on other mail servers. And this is where we have this open standard SMTP, which is used for sending mails from one server to another server. And that's very similar what we implemented in Nextcloud. So we have this federated sharing feature. Then if you want to share a document or file or folder, it doesn't matter, with others, you can also type in the share address of someone on a different server. The syntax is username at other server address. And then if you do that and press enter, then your server sends a request to this other server and say, hey, this user wants to share this file or folder or something with this other user. Do you accept it or not? And then the server will send a push notification or all kinds of notifications to the user and say, hey, there's this user Frank who wants to share this birthday photos folder with you. Do you want to accept it or not? And if you say yes, then those two servers, or more specifically, those two users on these two servers, they are connected and they have this shared folder. And everything that goes into the folder on one side pops up on the other side and the other way around. And you also have like the activities, for example, are also shared via the ActivityPub standard. Collaborative document editing actually also works. So you can then click on a document and someone else on the other server clicks on the same document, and you're in the same document with different cursors. That's quite cool. So you can work together like that. And we are also working on doing the same for chatting, for audio calling, video calling, and for chat. at the moment, everybody in the chat channel has to be on the same server or clicking on the invitation link that we can send by mail. Click on the link and then you're also in the channel. But you can't really like have people who are registered on a different server on your server. But that's something we are actually working on at the moment. And then this is also federated. And yeah, over time, we want to do this for every feature. It's just coming one step after another.